Welcome to another episode of In Conversation. This episode of In Conversation is different because circumstances are different. We are in the midst of a pandemic, a lockdown, and work from home. But as they say, the show must go on. For this episode of In Conversation, we have with us Mr. Arvind Kapil, who's the country head retail lending at HDFC Bank. So my first question to you, Arvind, is you under retail lending handle a wide array of businesses. Right from sustainable livelihood initiative, which caters to the bottom of the pyramid, to unsecured loans, to loan against property, loan against shares, retail working capital loans, auto and two-wheeler loans. So give us an insight into what is your outlook, keeping in mind the current circumstances of the lockdown and the pandemic.
Thanks, Rajiv. I think when I look at the entire gamut of the businesses that we are observing right now, and we look at the pandemic times in which we are surviving, I firmly believe right from the bottom of the pyramid, if you look at a microfinance loan, or you look at an unsecured loan for a salary profile, or you look at a mortgage set both for home and LAP, and if I transcend into the entire auto industry, one thing is coming out very clearly, and that is that prices actually is a great catalyst to reinvent yourself. Let me quantify that. I think we all, every single corporate, I'm sure across industries, has been working over the past at least half the decade on aspects of digitization and simplification towards the customers, the processes. But I think the need and the complete requirement of the ecosystem is completely precipitated to have this as of now, as of yesterday. So I think that's the new awakening, which I see is going to shape up the industries from here on, not just the financial industries, across the sectors, I feel. So I think one has to kind of start with a reset, rethink, and reinvent yourself, both customer journeys and the sales management processes that you're used to. So we'll have to really go back on the drawing board, start from the zero base, and actually reinvent the organization. And it's going to be an interesting journey from here on.
Thank you, Arvind. Now over to Neeraj. Neeraj, your questions, please.
Hi, Arvind. Lovely to have you. You know, it's very different talking to you, you know, remotely and digitally. You know, my question was, Arvind, you know, of the several firsts that Arvind's credited with, you know, the one that stands out in my memory is the 10 seconds loan. Is it too early for me to ask you this question, or are we in for something similar now that you have the charge of the auto loans business? You know, cars are not selling, and I don't see them selling in the next, you know, a few months.
Neeraj, that's a good question in terms of from an industry point of view. Let me begin by sharing that I think if you look at the last 3 years of the auto industry, they've been going through a rough patch incrementally. And ironically, by the way, a lot of economists have expressed a view that due to the reduced shared mobility and social distancing and reduced public transport utilization as the lockdown unfolds into and the market opens up, is going to be a positive trigger for the entire vehicle industry, both auto and two-wheelers. And another thing we see in the industry is the digital industry per se in isolation is growing at almost 40 to 50% across sectors. Now, I think both these industries, imagine if you were to envisage an auto industry highly digitized, you can imagine that the growth rates that we are talking, if you merge a 50% growing digital industry per se and an auto industry which is looking under stress prima facie, if you merge these two and create a new operating models with the manufacturers and actually make it so convenient for the customers. And that's exactly was the foundation for the 10 seconds loan. 10 seconds loan was nothing but amazing amount of simplicity leading to multiple levels of growth on the digitization and the business. And it's 4 years till now and we still see the growth continuing at a rapid rate. So I think I'm very optimistic on the auto and vehicle industry. Both due to the pent-up demand as well as probably the digitization creating new demand in itself. Because I think as you simplify things, it itself creates a massive amount of demand.
Thanks, Arvind. You know, how will this play out, the whole digitization journey? I mean, I would like to believe that, you know, to a large extent, the value chains digitized, other than the delivery of the car, aren't we as a bank, haven't we digitized the entire, or still there's some way to go?
I think we have digitized parts of the pieces. In the auto industry, you're well aware that I think there are various stakeholders in the game. You have the manufacturer, you've got the dealer, and you've got the banker, and you've got the customer. So unlike a personal loan, where you have the customer and the banker, here the stakeholders are far more. And then you've got to register the vehicle. So there's state laws. So keeping all this in mind, I think there are pieces which everybody is trying to digitize. The whole challenge is if we can make it at least 90% digital, then the whole, imagine a scenario, you go on the website, you choose the car you want, the banker knows, HDFC Bank has a system by which you actually make a few clicks, and with the manufacturer, you choose the preferred dealer, and the money gets transferred to the dealer, and the car comes to your doorstep. And maybe just to drop in the flow is the physical wet signature required for your state registration, which of course we are dependent on the states to digitize it. But until then, I think there's a whole lot of work can be done, and you can really move extremely fast for the vehicle to move to the customer, especially the times we are in right now.
I'm just, you know, compelled to ask this question to Arvind. You know, do you have, as the largest, you know, financer of auto loans, you know, do you have anything to say to the you know, auto industry, which might comfort them? And, you know, most people are talking about 3 months, if not more, when things are going to be, you know, normal, when the dealership is going to be open and for customers to visit. Would you have anything now to tell them, kind of make them feel a little better?
Very clearly, not just the auto industry, all industries, we'll have to forge better ecosystems for the customer experience. We will have to connect the dots, or reconnect the dots, if I may say, to see the future in a better light. How do I see the auto industry over the next 90 days once the lockdown is behind us? I think there's going to be two factors we must remember. There's going to be a huge pent-up demand. And the second is it's seasonal and cyclical demand's going to kick in the summers. So if you keep both these factors and we actually make it even convenient for the customer, the probability of it looking as optimistic uptake, I think looks very positive. And added to that, the social distancing, I think auto industry per se could be one of the few which I'm optimistic might see both, I think auto and two-wheelers might see an upward trajectory from here on. So it might take 2 months or 3 months for the demand and the supply to kind of match up to each other. And let's also remember, these are COVID times, and I read articles where they say COVID is like a wartime, Neeraj. But remember one thing, war destroys the factories, destroys the supply lines. Here, after the lockdown, everybody goes back to their factory. Government has created a stimulus package. We're talking about creating better capital access to the self-employed. We are talking about creating a much healthier system to fight back. Keeping all these factors in mind, I think we are entering a much positive ecosystem for us to see brighter side. So I'm an optimist in this.
I'm an optimist, coming as it does from Arvind, from the leader. I'm sure it must be comforting for the industry as a whole. Rajiv, your question, please.
Thanks, Neeraj. My question to Arvind is, the government has announced the entire SME loan structuring initiative or the program. How do you think it will play out for the SME businesses in India?
I think there are two factors that I have understood from the package, and they're more fundamental in nature. I think the first is, I think increased focus on supply chain localization is what fundamentally the government is trying to strengthen. So if you look back, whether you look back at the labor reforms efforts recently, or you look back a year back when they, or less than a year back when they announced new taxes for corporates, and they said that manufacturers, I think the tax rate was 15%, if I remember or recall correctly. So if you connect all these dots together, I think the whole thrust is to create a robust boost for domestic manufacturing and hoping that it will also catch up on the export side. Having said that, I think the step that I feel is a very definitive and probably really value-adding to the self-employed businessman today is the initiative the government has launched, in my understanding, on the SME. And it's a clear package which talks about customers who have loans up to a certain month will get probably 15 to 20% incrementally with moratorium, and they can pay back over a period of time. I think capital is the biggest enabler right now to get businessmen back on its feet. So even if the government, to my mind, would have done taxes and reforms, I think it would have probably appealed to some segment. But in my view, capital is a far bigger enabler when you're coming out of crisis and actually catapulting yourself back on its feet.
Thanks, Arvind. My next question to you is on the domestic consumption. And this is, we are turning our gaze to the entire unsecured loan portfolio. Keeping in mind the current circumstances, do you think things will pan out when it comes to consumption by, let's say, the salaried or the working class, as far as, let's say, the personal loans are concerned, that particular business?
Yeah, Rajiv, the way I see the consumer behavior, I think I see two patterns emerging. I think one is, I do see a rise in precautionary savings, which I think will go through a slight increase, I think for a few months. And I think that's natural after such a crisis. And I also see the discretionary spending coming back to normal within the early few months. And I would see it as the new normal. Also keep in mind that if you look at from a finance point of view, and if you look at from the amount of penetration levels that retail lending, if I were to throw a perspective on that, and look at from a financial eye, the retail lending is also a great booster for consumption. But if you look at the penetration levels of the retail lending today in India, is so considerably low debt to GDP ratio that actually there's a huge upside in it. So when we do our analysis and try and get a sense of the customer behavior, always keep in mind that even if there is a disruption of salary for 10% or 15%, it's not going to shake the ecosystem to an extent of lending completely going through a rejig or a revaluation of the way you want to look at it. So I think we are at a stage where I think there's moderation in salaries or increments which corporates are looking at. And we got to watch it carefully. I think it's prudent to do that. But I think nothing beyond that. I think the opportunity stays highly underpenetrated. This country has a huge upside on the retail lending opportunity. And I think that's the way I like to see the whole sector.
You know, Arvind, I just wanted to ask you, how is this seen at SLI space, which is the bottom of the pyramid? What are you hearing from the ground? How do you see it now? And how do you see things changing, post the pandemic?
I think it's a very good area you've touched on. And I think there are a lot of learnings which I think the rest of economy can learn from the microfinance segment. If you look at the history over the last 5 years, we've had the demonetization where microfinance segment got slightly hit. We had the Andhra Pradesh issue where there were government certain regulations where microfinance had went through a certain cycle. We had the Kerala floods. Which caused a certain havoc in that particular state for obviously the bottom of the pyramid customer that's taking lending. But you know, in all these few cases that I gave you, they're the most resilient. I mean, within 90 days to 120 days, these guys are completely back, paying on time, delinquency trends are not going out of whack. And I think it speaks really good about the credit behavior of the bottom of the pyramid of this country. I think if we take a cue of the microfinance business and extrapolate our analysis to the middle class of this country, which forms the formidable backbone of this country, when we assess our options as to post-lockdown and the behavioral, consumer behavioral trends and the survival rates and how well we'll emerge out of this, I think it's a very promising story to look at the microfinance segment and see that I think very comfortably you will have a very highly resilient middle class coming out of this. And I don't see a dramatic change if we were to open the lockdown probably by June.
So right now there is a COVID lockdown and people are operating remotely and everyone is learning to adapt and learning new things as days are passing. So from your end, what are the key leadership lessons that you have learned and would like to share with everyone?
I think the biggest lesson is ability and flexibility of an organization to have the courage to constantly reinvent itself. You don't need a crisis to reinvent yourself. I think we need a culture which constantly reinvents itself, reinvents better ways to engage with customers, more simple, more automated, more digital maybe, reinventing your sales management journeys, re-looking at your new ways of distribution, and constantly challenging yourself to re-look at new ways and more cost-effectively to do business. If you look at the COVID crisis, it's taught us that remote working is going to be the new normal. It's not like everybody didn't realize that it could be possible, but today when you're living it, the learning is far more intense and far more profound. But I think the whole world can't go through crisis to constantly innovate. You've got to have innovation as a culture by itself in every walk of life at your corporate level. And I think that's what will keep us more agile and keep us alive.
So, you know, there are a couple of questions, Arvind, my colleagues have sent for you. Ravindran wants you to tell us any new strategy or idea for auto loan financing. And Sanjay has something related. He says, do you see the possibility of online sale and finance of vehicles on platforms like Zoom and customers not having to visit a showroom?
Reset us. We are rethinking the customer journey. We are rethinking our sales management journey. We're trying to forge a better ecosystem. So yes, the straight answer to your question is yes, I envisage not very far from now a complete online end-to-end system across multiple access points for customers for auto loans. I think the biggest possible positive takeaway for the businesses will also be how to integrate remote working as a new normal. And I think the better any company can integrate that, that could be game changer, because then subsequent cost questions and cost advantages kick in terms of how commercial establishment will be better utilized, optimized rather, and how you're going to scale up much quicker through the digital platform. So I think the go-to-market speed might go substantially higher and at a much more lower cost and more cost effectively.
Rohit has sent me one, and he's saying, so I'll read out verbatim, Arvind, for you. So I'm not sure if we can ask this, but here it goes. Given that work from home is looking like the future of work for many, many companies, do you think it will have any bearing on auto sales? This is because a lot of people either use taxis, aggregators to reach office. But if people aren't going to office and working from home, do you see it leading to reduction in demand for autos and consequently auto loans? I thought it was a good question.
Neeraj, I think it's a good question, but you'll appreciate that I think there's only so many things one can, you know, watch through the crystal gaze and predict in the future. So I think, in my view, the convenience of digitization and making it easy for the customer, the kind of growth that that'll catapult the whole industry to, should outweigh this whole concept of remote working as an acceptable norm. And that's purely my assessment of the situation. We'll have to actually walk the road and actually see how it spans out. But I think people are going to buy vehicles, both two-wheelers and auto, also keeping in mind the whole shared, reduced shared mobility. And I think that's more fundamental in nature. Also, people might be a little more careful with public transport for a couple of months, till we get a more tight handle on the situation. So I think as the demand unfolds, we see this situation fundamentally as not a demand issue, not a supply issue, as a total customer access issue. So as the customer access opens up, I think this whole demand will unfold to a positive trajectory.
Thank you, Arvind, for your time. And you know, before we end, and I could not ask you this question. How's been this experience of talking to us remotely and digitally? Well, all of us are sitting at different locations within Bombay.
Neeraj, I think it's a paradigm shift, and it's a new normal. So I think it's kind of a dawning on all of us, or calling on all of us, that how exactly the whole world has changed around us. And we're kind of adjusting to it and kind of thriving it. It's been a pleasure talking to all of you through this medium.
Thank you, Arvind. It's been a pleasure having you on this call. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Arvind. And with that, we come to the end of the episode of In Conversation. Interesting discussion. And let me also tell you that Arvind has many innovations under his belt, be it the 10 seconds PL, instant mutual funds, the loan against shares. So keep an eye on many more innovations in the time to come. I'm sure there are many more in the offing from Arvind. So with that, would like to say goodbye. So thank you so much for watching In Conversation. Stay tuned for more.